Okay, hi everyone. I'm Guillaume Black here, and yes, I'm a Google Developer Expert on Google Cloud. And today I will talk to you about how to take over the control of the serverless security. Because serverless is a new trend to develop applications in the web, and it's great to have some best practice in security. I'm also a cloud architect at Sphere. Sphere is a consultancy company in France focused on Google Cloud. But before going deeper into security in serverless, I would like to define more precisely what's serverless. Serverless, you can see it in two different manner, in fact. You can see the serverless as an operational model, and you can see this as you have nothing to manage, no server to manage, no network to manage, all the firewalls, the routings, the server management and patching is performed by the cloud provider, and you don't care about this part. In addition, you pay only when you use the service, and you don't have to provision and to deprovision the servers. All this part is also managed by the cloud provider, and you pay only when your service run, and when you have no traffic, you pay nothing. That's for the operational part. You have also another point of view for the serverless. It's the developer point of view. In fact, a developer wants to develop a service, a microservices, because it's the microservice is the fashion today. And these services react to events. It could be cloud events or also external events, such as HTTPS requests. And from the developer point of view, what is important is to deploy the service on a server, on a platform, on Azure, on AWS, on Google Cloud, on-premise. It's not the concern of the developer. The developer wants something portable to deploy the service and to bring the value to the customers, to the users, and then to achieve its work. So you have two points of view for serverless, and in this talk, the point of view is more about the operational model than the programming model. And when you talk about security in serverless compute, what is serverless compute on Google Cloud? In fact, we have three main products in serverless compute, because in serverless, we have a lot of products in serverless on Google Cloud, such as BigQuery, Dataflow, and so on. But in this talk, I will focus on three services, which are Cloud Function. Cloud Function is a very simple service. In fact, you write a function, a small piece of code, and then you ship it in the cloud. Google Cloud gets the code, compiles it, packages it, and then deploy it somewhere on servers. I don't know, it's serverless. I don't know where are the servers. It's not my concern, but you can run only one piece of code when you use Cloud Function. If you want to serve more endpoints and more URL paths, it's better to have web servers and then to serve all these paths. And like this, you can use a Cloud Run. With Cloud Run, you package your web server in a container, and then you ship your container, and the container is deployed also on servers, on cluster, I don't know where. And the container is served on internet. But it's more defined for the backends because it's more API oriented. If you don't want to manage a container, if you want to only provide your source of your web server, you can use App Engine. App Engine, it's the oldest service of Google Cloud, and you send only your sources, and the container is built by Google Cloud, and then deploy also like Cloud Run, but not on Cloud Run infrastructure, on App Engine infrastructure. And App Engine is the oldest services deployed in 2008. So very early, 2 years before the beginning of AWS, and it's one of the oldest serverless services on public cloud provider today. So I will focus only on these three services. Why? Because you have your code that you can deploy on the platform. And when you have some question from security team, your manager, sometimes your customer about the security, you have to answer them correctly. And some question can be naive, and you have to answer some questions such as how do you manage the patching? And how to patch the servers because you don't have the servers. It's difficult to answer these kind of questions. How do you manage the network? And typically, how to use static IP to access other services, or how to make your service private and not reachable from the internet. Because you don't manage the server, you don't manage the network, it could be tricky to do this and to answer this kind of question. Or he comments if it's a customer. And how to ensure the high availability of your service? How do you control the access? Who can access, and how to be sure that anybody can access the service? And of course, if you have an attack, how to mitigate this attack, such as DDoS attacks. So all questions, not really easy to answer, and I will provide you some tips and schema to achieve this kind of answers to this. So how to take over the control? First, how to patch the server? Of course, it's serverless. You don't manage the servers and you have no server patching to achieve. This part is very easy. But when you create an application, you will write your code, and this code has some dependencies. And with create function and app engine, you bring only your code and the dependencies. And sometimes in the dependencies or even in your code, you have some security issues that you have to fix. And when you use Cloud Run, of course, you bring your code and your dependencies, but also the container with the base image and with maybe some system dependencies that you have installed on this base image. And you have to patch all this container because also sometimes you have some security issues in the base image on the or the system dependencies. For this, so you don't have nothing to do. You don't have to patch the servers, but you have to patch your application and your runtime environments, in fact. A best practice, for example, is to deploy every week or every month the same code, even if you have no change in the code, and to repackage with the latest version of the dependencies or of the base image for the containers to run your unit test or your integration test to be sure that the code continues to work as expected, and then to redeploy regularly with the latest version of the dependencies or the containers to be sure to be up to date with the latest patch in your application. The next points are about the network management. Because sometimes you have some serverless apps on your side, Cloud Function, Cloud Run, or App Engine, and you need to reach only internal services, such as Compute Engine or Kubernetes Engine, or maybe some products in Google Cloud, Cloud Memory Store, which is a Redis managed on Google Cloud, can be accessed only with private IP. And how to do this with serverless product, because with serverless, I repeat, you don't manage the server and the network. Same thing when you have an external platform to reach, for example, your on-prem environments, and you need to reach it with private IP through a VPN or an interconnect. The solution for this, it's an important tool or feature on the serverless world, is named Serverless VPC Connector. In fact, this connector, it's a bridge between your serverless world, where you know you manage nothing, and your VPC, your virtual private cloud, where you can route the traffic from the serverless world to your VPC, and then you are in your VPC, and you manage what you want in it. You can access internal resources connected to your VPC. You can enforce some firewall rules, and then you can route the traffic. For example, you can route the traffic from the VPC to a VPN to reach your on-premise environment. At the opposite, sometimes you want to go out with a specific IP because you have a service outside that trusts maybe a login and password, but also the source IP of the request. It was a case in one of my company where we had a FTP server, and we to connect it, we need to have the login, the password, and to confirm the correct source IP. And because it's serverless, all the products, when they go to internet, use a shared IPs on Google Cloud. And in fact, any solution, any cloud function, any app engine from my project or from the project of the others on the world can use the same IP to go on internet. So you can't trust the platform IPs. To solve this, here again, you need to use the serverless VPC connector, and then you have to route the traffic from your serverless world to your VPC, and then to plug on your VPC, you plug a cloud router to route the traffic to a cloud NAT, and in cloud NAT, you can reserve some IP, the IP dedicated to you, to your platform, and then you can trust them because you are the only one to use them to reach your external platform in this case. However, this solution is only available on Cloud Function and Cloud Run because I said before, App Engine is an old service and there is some legacy on the environments, and it's not possible to have the same feature in the serverless world. Okay, now we can go outside with a static IP, but sometimes we can want also to discard any private IP to reach public IP to reach our service, because the service is only internal. You don't have to access or to be accessed from the external, such as background process, because you have some sensitive data processed by the application. Donc you don't want that external call come in from your come to your serverless apps, and also to reduce the attack surface, because if you have less service exposed on internet, of course you have less attacks, or you don't let the capacity of bad actors to attack you. With Cloud Run and Cloud Function, you have the capacity to control the ingress and where the ingress comes from. With App Engine, so it's also a quite old service, you have something like firewall rules. It's not exactly the same process, but yeah, you can do stuff with App Engine, but here it's really focused for Cloud Function and Cloud Run. The ingress controls say, I accept only the traffic coming from my VPC. And nowhere, if the traffic comes from the public IP, the traffic will be rejected, and the only traffic accepted by the platform is coming from my VPC, not the VPC from the other customers, my VPC in my project. So now, if you want to call, for example, a Cloud Run service from a Cloud Function, you need to come from the VPC. And for this, of course, you use the serverless VPC connector to come from the serverless world to go to the VPC, and then you are in the VPC, you can reach a private serverless product. Of course, because you have also other resources on your VPC, for example, Compute Engine or Kubernetes Engine, you can access to the serverless apps from these products. And also, if you have an external platform, your on-prem environments, and you are connected to your VPC through a VPN or an interconnect, of course, it's possible also to reach your serverless apps through this private link, because you land in your VPC, and then the next hop is your serverless world. That's for the ingress control. You can set the ingress control as internal, but you can also say, I accept the internal traffic and the traffic coming from the cloud load balancing. And like this, you can add a load balancer, and the traffic will be able to come from a load balancer and go to the serverless apps. And you can expose, for example, a public IP in front of your serverless apps. So your serverless apps are still public, but not directly reachable from the internet to the serverless apps, you need to go to the serverless, to the load balancer to reach it. Else your traffic is disordered and rejected. And of course, you can also use the traffic coming from your private cloud to the cloud load balancing and have, for example, an internal load balancer if you want, and then to route the traffic to your serverless app. Next point about the high availability. Just before going deeper, just to remember, when you deploy code on serverless products, by default, your deployment is high available at regional scale. What means one region on GCP have at least three zones. If you want a zone is a data center, and then to be highly available for about the region, you have to deploy at least in each zone in a region to be high available. So by default, when you use Cloud Run, App Engine, or Cloud Function, you are high available at regional scale. But if you want to be high available at global scale, you need to use an HTTP global HTTPS load balancer and to have an Anycast IP to broadcast, in fact, to have an Anycast IP which is deployed and understood in any part of the world. Then you can deploy multiple backends, for example, Cloud Run, you can deploy it on each region in the world. And you can also deploy, for example, App Engine. App Engine is only mono region. You can deploy it in multiple regions in the same project, but with Cloud Function, you can do this. And what is very great with an HTTPS load balancer, in fact, the traffic is routed to the closest location to the users. That means if I'm in Australia, for example, if I request my Cloud Run service, I will go to the Australia location. And if I request, for example, the Cloud Function, there is no Cloud Function in Australia, and the HTTPS load balancer will route it to the closest location. I don't know what is the closest location from Australia, the US West Coast, or the Europe. I don't know, but the load balancer knows this and routes the traffic to the closest location. And of course, if, for example, you have a major outage in Australia and you can't access the Australia region because you have a major outage, the traffic is routed to the other available region, and that is very great to have an high availability at global scale. Just a warning on this, most of the time, the processing part is not the problem when you go global to deploy your application. Most of the time, it's the data. The data is a problem to have a global database and accessible from anywhere in the world. And sometimes it's the part the most difficult, not the processing. But it's at least great to have some solution like this to be global. So now, how to access to your service? In fact, when you deploy something on Cloud Function or Cloud Run, your service is deployed behind Google Frontend. Google Frontend is a layer responsible of many things. One of the things is to host the TLS certificate to have a SSL connection to your service. But also, you can ask Google Frontend to filter the traffic and to accept only the valid traffic. If you deploy a Cloud Function and a Cloud Run in private mode, that means you require an authenticated connection to the service, authenticated and authorized connection to the service. Google Frontend will perform three things. The first one is to validate the token. Token is expired, the token is valid, the signature is valid. So the token must be valid. The second thing is the identity must be known. And the third thing is the identity is known, but the identity must be authorized on the service. And if these three actions are not valid, the request is discarded. What's mean also if you have an attack, if you have a DDoS attack, for example, all the bad traffic is filtered by Google frontend, and you pay nothing because it's on Google parts, and you pay only for the valid requests that come from Google frontend to your cloud function or to your cloud run. And like this, you pay only the real job that you do, and all the bad traffic is not for you, it's for Google. But sometimes this pattern has a problem because you need to provide an OAuth2 token in the header of your request, and some platform can't provide this kind of token because of their legacy, because technically they can't. So for this, you can update and improve your extend your capacity of authentication thanks to API gateway or cloud endpoints. In fact, API gateway, it's the serverless product of cloud endpoints. Cloud endpoints, you have to manage it by yourselves, and API gateway, it's the serverless mode of cloud endpoints. And thanks to API gateway or cloud endpoints, you can add the API keys and Firebase auth authentication capacity, and then to accept the traffic from this kind of authentication and use the service account, the identity, in fact, of API gateway or cloud endpoints to generate an OAuth2 token to put it in the header and then to forward the request to your serverless product. And in addition, with API gateway and cloud endpoints, when you use API keys, you can add quotas and rate limits on your paths, on your endpoints, to be sure that all the usage are fair on your services. Then the last one is the DDoS attacks. I already talked about Google Frontend, which is a Google layer in front of all services. I mean Google services, not Google Cloud services. It's really a Google services that protects also Gmail, YouTube, and other platforms such as Maps and so on, and also protect your service in the same manner, and already prevent some attacks of layer 3, such as partial IP or incorrect IP format and so on. You have a lot of traffic already discarded by default thanks to Google Frontend. But you can also add a load balancer in front of your service, and on the global HTTPS load balancer, you can add Cloud Armor. Cloud Armor, it's a customizable WAF, web application firewall, and you can add some rules and policies to filter, to accept some IPs or to reject some IPs, to reject IPs coming from some parts of the world. So you can add a lot of policies, and it could be very efficient to mitigate your attacks and the location of your attacks if you know them. And I recommend you to have a look on it because it's a very powerful tool for this. So just to conclude, the security is not very easy with serverless because it's not the same paradigm as before, because serverless is a new paradigm. You have no server, no network to manage, and thus the security is quite different as the legacy world, but it's important. And I read somewhere this sentence, it's not from me, it's from someone who say, if the security goes well, your business will follow. And I'm sure you have in your mind a lot of example of company with great product, very promising, and because there were some security issues, the products crash or have difficulties to continue to live because the product have lost the confidence and the trust of the users, and you can't continue to use this if you don't trust the service. So think about the security, it's very important. Sometimes it's boring. I know it's not very fun to work on security, but it's very important when you have a product in production, and it's important to focus on this. That's all for me. I would like to thank you for your attention and to be here. If you want to follow me, you can follow me on Twitter. I will publish the slides. If you want to have access to the slides, I will publish them on Twitter. Also write some articles on Medium about security and serverless, because it's the two topics that I love on Google Cloud. And if you want to ask me a question on Twitter, on Medium, on LinkedIn, or where you want, don't hesitate to reach me. I don't know if you have time for questions now, but so if you have a question, I will be happy to answer you now, else it's for later. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much too. Thank you for the such nice slide over the six main serverless security topics that are really in top right now. So I'm really excited for follow the slide back and get in contact with you. Also, the really nice thing that you mentioned about the new features that Google Cloud Platform has. So about the web firewall and the OWASP top 10 securities. So really nice that we have all things together in one talk. I believe now we can check for feedback and check for questions. And I'm going to do this. If there is some, I will read it for you and we will start the questions. But for now, I have one small thing. What are the sources for information that you use for gathering the security topic over the Google Cloud Platform?
There is no security topic exactly for Google Cloud Platform, and sometimes it's a problem. I'm following the news on the platform, and some new release are focused on the security, and that's why I added in my package and my bag. But yes, you have to check what's new, and you have also to deploy on real production your services and to ask yourself, I would like to do this. Okay, I will go deeper in the documentation and search which feature can help me to answer this. And it's not really easy at the end, and that's why I like to perform this talk, because you have a summary of all what can you do on serverless environment on Google Cloud, a summary of what you do, because there's a full section on Google Cloud documentation for this.
Yeah, right, exactly. So I'm also trying to get more and more on the news for the security in the serverless world. But I see that the nice approach is just to follow the news and use the practical approach. Okay.
Yeah, for instance, following the news, it's quite time consuming. And so I'm a GDE, I'm passionate by Google Cloud, and I follow this every day. But when you are just a developer, a practitioner, focus on Google Cloud, but also on the platforms, it's difficult to follow all the news, because Azure, AWS, Google Cloud has a lot of release every day, and it's difficult to follow. And yeah, sometimes it's difficult to have the good news at the right time.
You're right.